Our first speaker today is Rainer Spanager, Germany, and we're going to talk about Alpha. Okay.
So good morning, everybody. I didn't think I needed a microphone, right? For the taping, you need a microphone. You're saying?
No.
It's fine.
Yeah, we're good.
Okay. So in terms of the videotaping, if there come some slides with unpublished results, I will tell you not to take it. And this is also something that I would like to comment on in a very general way. What I do not understand these days is if you go to a scientific meeting, that everyone is sitting there these days with a smartphone and is taking photos. That's completely unacceptable. I mean, either you go to a meeting where you see only published work, then you can take all your photos if you wish. But if there is unpublished work presented, how can you take photos? And this, I don't know how this habit came into place, because it is even illegal. And one has to do something about it. Otherwise, people will not show any more unpublished work, and there is actually then no need to go to any meeting anymore. So I'm working at the Central Institute of Mental Health. This is a huge psychiatric clinic located in the area of Heidelberg, Mannheim, in Germany. About 1,200 people are working there, and we are affiliated with the University of Heidelberg, but we have our own budget. So in principle, it works like a Max Planck Institute. And what we're doing there since many years, we really try to combine basic research with clinical needs. So to speak, translational research, everyone today is doing translational research, at least on paper, but to do it in a real way that you communicate between the needs of clinicians and that you implement it into the clinical world and vice versa. This needs a culture of exchange that can only develop over years and years. And many places actually do not have such a culture. So I will try to talk a little bit about translational work, but there will be also Markus Heilig talking tomorrow, also about alcohol addiction and translational work. We exchanged our talks yesterday, so there is only one very minor overlap. Not that we get any duplications here. So just to give the numbers in relationship, we do have worldwide 2 billion people who do drink alcohol on a regular basis, and about 1.3 billion smokers, and a much lower number of illicit drug users. So especially here in Europe, where alcohol drinking is deeply embedded into our culture, it is a problem. Basically, I was always, like a couple of years ago, I was always saying there are some good things about drinking alcohol, but it has changed somehow, even in my own perspective. I mean, drinking alcohol, it is connected to, at least in a negative way, to 200 diseases. So it affects a lot of cancers, immunological diseases, psychiatric diseases. So it's not doing good. Even very small amounts of alcohol are not very healthy, I have to say. But Markus, he will certainly talk more about this. But the question is, why do we take drugs? what do we trade out with? I mean, it is a little bit strange that 2 billion people worldwide do drink alcohol, and I mean, most of them are really aware that it can have negative consequences. And if you would talk to an addiction researcher or a psychologist, such a person would say, because it is reinforcing. And this goes back to the concept of James Olds, who developed with others the concept of positive reinforcement of drugs of abuse, and he also discovered the reward, the reinforcement system, which you have heard about probably. But this concept, it is good for us to work in. But if you ask someone on the street, why do you drink alcohol? You would never, ever get as an answer, because it's reinforcing, right? It's a psychological concept we are living in. It's not a motif why people do drink alcohol and, or take drugs. And this is why I think this is a really nice paper from Christian Müller and Günther Schumann, but basically from Christian Müller, who had developed this idea of drugs being instruments. So what they are saying, that drug instrumentalization is a learned behavior designed to change the mental state and thereby improve the current quality of life by taking psychoactive drugs. So you do drink alcohol because you have, at this specific time point, a specific need. Maybe you are completely stressed out and you do need to have a drink. Maybe you just want to relax. Maybe you're just out with some friends. Maybe you're just forced to drink alcohol because you go to a party, you celebrate something. There are hundreds of motifs why you do drink alcohol, why you take drugs. There's not any motif that would say because it's reinforcing. And these motifs, they're changing also within individuals. You have one reason today why you drink alcohol, and there might be another reason tomorrow why you drink alcohol. And you can think about yourself. I don't know who smokes, I don't know who drinks alcohol. Think about yourself, why and when you drink alcohol. And you will see that this changes throughout your whole life. There will be just within, we're in a big network called Imagine, and this will be published, I guess, next week. So it's a kind of milestone work where in 2,000 people, we tried, or actually the consortium tried to find out what are the reasons why young people do drink alcohol. So the question was, at an age of 14, 2,000 people, young adolescents, were checked on their genetic profile, were checked on their neurobiological profile by various imaging techniques, functional tasks, and also about their history. So what happened so far in life with you until age of 14. And then 2 years later, it was estimated who drinks alcohol excessively. Alcohol binging, big thing in Europe. Not that much in the US, but in Europe, big thing. Especially in the UK, it's a nightmare. So, and the biggest factor that comes into game is romantic events. So, if you have, if you will have kids that will be 13, 14, and they fall in love, and usually that doesn't work out at this age very nicely. So, 2 years later, the likelihood that you will do alcohol binging is extremely high. So history is the most important thing that drives later drug use or alcohol use. It is not
just high for this. You mean any romantic event or unsuccessful romantic
event? This is the point usually with the age of 13, 14, it ends up to be unsuccessful. In most cases, there are exceptions.
That's for binge drinking, becoming addict.
No, that's not for becoming addict. We're talking about alcohol drinking, excessive alcohol drinking, and also the binging behavior. You know, the KO drinking, the binging, that's what is predicted here. And there are also baseline drinking, how much you drank before. And most importantly, this is not shown here, is also first time of drink, when you drink. As later as you have contact with alcohol, as better it is, especially in terms of the development of addiction. So this is one of the strongest factors. But this also, if you look, for example, genes, here are a few SNPs shown. The genes, they do not impact a lot, so genetics, on 2 years later excessive drinking. Also other, like brain activation, etc., reward outcome. So it is history that counts a lot. I'm not saying that genes do not count, and we will talk about this a little bit later. But if you screen for single variations, usually you do not get a big effect.
I think that
it's inside. Yeah.
It's really strange.
Yeah.
What was your explanation?
What
was your interpretation?
Pure descriptor. That's all. I mean, this is just 14 to 16 years. I don't know how stable it is. We will do now, we will evaluate these 2,000 kids, young adults, in age of 18, 19. That's a third wave. This is just happening, and we will see how stable it is. That's still no question. So, you see, history is, your individual history is important for later alcohol consumption. But why, what are the reasons? Why do we drink, especially here in Europe, so much alcohol? So you could take also, in order to answer this, a more evolutionary perspective. And this is what we try to do. And the idea is that there is a long selective regime of low alcohol availability in fruit-eating human and pre-human ancestors. So if you go 200,000 years back, food sources were a problem. We're always out there for food. And certainly, ripening fruits were something that you were really looking for because it's a very valuable source of carbohydrates, something that you need. And in ripening fruits, you do have really low, it depends on the level of the ripening fruit, you have low amounts of alcohol. So alcohol
help probably to detect valuable sources of nutrition. So in this sense, primates, humans, probably there was a natural selection for these, for all genetic traits that detected alcohol, and it was all in a positive way. So whatever you developed in terms of a behavioral feature that was geared towards alcohol, it helped to get better food. So that was a very positive selection, probably, for alcohol for hundreds or millions of years, So it seems to be that there is an evolutionary built-in program that helps us to get to alcohol. And the problem started then 9,000 years ago, where actually in this city of Yao in China, people started to invent how to brew alcoholic beverages. So they had a kind of beer, wine, and it was 9,000 years ago. And here all of a sudden, higher alcohol concentrations occur. You know, so this was within a beverage, all of a sudden within food sources and fruits, it's max 0.5 percent alcohol, and all of a sudden it came up to 5, 8, 10%. So that was a problem, because when you start drinking these alcoholic drinks, you get an intoxication, something that did not happen before. So it was impossible to eat that many fruits to get intoxicated. But with this event, the consumption of alcohol to intoxication was all of a sudden possible. And there was a reversal of selective pressures. That was not good anymore, but everything was shaped to be good. However, time period, we had just 9,000 years to adapt to this new situation. I mean, it's a long time, but probably a couple million years before everything was positively shaped. So in other, so you could say that alcohol drinking today, or excessive drinking in humans, is an evolutionary hangover. That's the idea. Whether this is really true, but it is a nice evolutionary theory. And we, some years ago, we actually found a missing link in an evolutionary sense, which means it's a missing trait, that we found that there is chronic alcohol consumption by mammals in the wildlife. And that was so far not reported. I mean, occasionally there are observations that animals, for example, elephants, drink alcohol, right? You will find this in newspapers from time to time. And there is this old Walt Disney movie, I don't know, the Life in the Desert or something, where so many people, where so many animals, mammals get drunk. There are only occasional reports and nothing really proven. And one of my co-workers, Frank Wins, he did a field study in Western Malaysia, where this is Frank, where he found that he could smell all the time alcohol in the area where he was working. He was working on a different project. But he found out that this inflorescence of the Burton palm produces alcohol. And this is a very active process. So it is not what you happening usually, what's happening usually with plants, that nectar is produced, and the nectar has high sugar content, and then different yeast populations can go on this and can produce alcohol, right? To a low content. Here it is a little bit different. These inflorescences are like active brewing chambers. So the nectar that is dripping out here is already having high alcohol content, up to 4%. So we're talking about light beer, or not light beer, about beer actually. And we detected a lot of new yeast species with a high alcohol tolerance, up to 10%. And so these yeast populations, they're working here like it's a brewing chamber. So that's the first description of a plant that actively generates alcohol containing nectar. And the other part of the story is this animal. I don't know whether any one of you does know this animal. Any guess?
But it seems to be like a hamster with a pig.
It is a tupaia, a tree shrew, a pentailed tree shrew. And it's actually the first time that someone catched a pentail with its fun, catch the pentail tree shrew and put on this transmitter to observe the animal. It's extremely difficult to catch these animals. And I don't know why, but the movie did not get integrated, so I show it to you here. So this is happening during night hours. These are night active animals. This is a Burton palm. This is the pentail tree shrew. So you can imagine what is happening, because this animal is the sole pollinator of the Burton palm, the only pollinator. And this animal lives basically on the Burton palm all night long. Exactly. So, I should also say that these animals are, at least if we trace back 90 million years, we have the same ancestors. Here is the Homo sapiens, the primates, and here is the Ptittosaurus, the pentail tree shrew we're talking about. So we do have the same ancestors 90 million years ago, but these animals lived for millions and millions of years in this very tiny habitat where the Burton palm and the animal lived in a symbiosis, so to speak. So the Burton palm needs, for pollination, the pentail tree shrew, and the pentail tree shrew needs this nectar. It took us in front a long time, 3 years of hard field work. It's completely different than in the lab, what you're used to make an estimation of how much alcohol a pentail tree shrew would drink per night. And he came up with a final estimation of about 4 grams per kilogram. This is 1.5 bottles of vodka per day. So that's a lot of alcohol. So, in other words, this is the first description of chronic intake of a psychoactive drug, alcohol, by mammals, the natural and ancient ecosystem. And
did you evaluate it in metabolism of alcohol in Italian? Yeah. 4 grams?
Exactly. I took out the data. I mean, the question was really, how can they survive? How can they survive? If they would get really intoxicated, I mean, I don't think they would have made a couple millions of years in this ecosystem. So they have developed an alternative metabolism. It was difficult to figure this out because blood join with these animals, that's impossible. Their skin, I mean, you would prank. We took the best meals and they prank. You cannot get through the skin. So we did hair sampling of animals, and in hair tissues, you can detect metabolites. And we found out that they have an alternative metabolism, glucuronidization. See, have a metabolism towards ethyl glucuronate. So that's something we have also to a small degree, especially if we drink a lot of alcohol, you can use this as a marker. But usually this part of metabolism in humans is very low. So here it's strongly upregulated. So they are probably having a very good metabolism of alcohol, and I don't think that they get really intoxicated, but they do drink a lot of alcohol. And we made also field experiments where we had sources of natural nectar and then of artificial nectar, sorry. And then we took an alternative food source of the nectar plus alcohol. And we built it nectar tripping boards and videotape the visits per night, and we could show that the animals do have built in a real selection towards alcohol plus nectar. So they go for this source. So they are really having a very positive selection. Another conclusion from the first part, excessive alcohol consumption in humans is an evolutionary hangover, and individual history impacts most on excessive alcohol consumption in young people.
Yes, for curiosity, is the only mice who drink the nectar in this plant?
Yeah.
This is very curious, yeah. Because the other
There are a few, there are two rat species. Insects cannot pollinate this one. It does not work. Physically it does not work. This we tested. And there are two rat species that occasionally visit also the Burton palm, but it is very unlikely that these animals act as pollinators. It is also the pentailed that helps for the pollination. So, I mean, no insects, that's for certain, that can be excluded, and two other species that go to this
pond. Do you think one reason is because of the high content of alcohol in the nectar? Maybe they are intoxicated and they don't like it?
That could be that other animals did not adapt to this and get intoxicated, and that would be then a problem. Not only that they don't like it, they would probably not survive, because to be intoxicated in the nature, it is a little bit dangerous.
How much they use these nectar? Till they become food from it, or they become drunk? Something like this, and then they stop drinking this.
They probably don't get really drunken, because, as I said, they do have this alternative metabolism that probably is much more efficient than our metabolism. So
it's kind of
so it's a
feeding.
Fast. They eat this nectar. It's their food.
Source of the
it's their food. So, we do this on the Oktoberfest. Italians like it. So, many people do drink alcohol, but only some of them develop a real problem, so to speak. And this is what we're talking about, addiction. They are getting addicted. And it is hard to say whether it's person A, B, C, or D who will have a problem later on. It's a big question, and we'll have people like Piavi Piazza talking about these individual differences that predispose. But roughly speaking, it's a minority, like 10, max 15% of people are exposed regularly to a drug, get really addicted. So why do some and why do others not get addicted? Is this too dark? Actually, not that you're falling asleep already in the morning. You can...
No, we got adopted.
You got adopted?
Yeah.
Okay. So the risk for disease is determined by our genes and by the environment. And we do have two extremes, like chorea huntington, that is on the very right side, so it's almost only genetically driven by repeating the Huntington gene, or silicose, which is purely environmentally driven disease, where in China each year more than 30,000 people die of, because of you get silicose in mining. But usually the concept we're living in, and it's also true for addiction, alcohol dependence, it's a gene-environment interaction. It's extremely difficult to understand gene-environment interactions, very hard to describe them. Can publish sometimes if you find such an interaction, no one will be able to repeat it then. But this is the concept we're living in. So what is the contribution of the genes? And this afternoon, Torgerson from Decode Genetics, the world champions in genetics, Decode, I have to say, right? They're acting on a completely different level than all other university-based labs. But just a few words to genetics, because I don't think that Torger will do this on such a simple level. So the inheritance of addictive disorders has been demonstrated by studies on families, studies on adoptees, and correlations of monozygotic and dizygotic twins. So especially helpful are studies in monozygotic, dizygotic twins. And if you compare concordance rates, so what is the percentage of how many of twin pairs get alcohol dependent, you will see that this is higher in monozygotic than in dizygotic twins. So that's already very strong indication that we do have here a genetic contribution. If you look into studies on adoptees, so one of the parents is an alcoholic, here another condition, none of the parents is an alcoholic, and then you do an adaptation by non-related families, and families where no alcohol problem to occur, you do have a 2.5 higher degree of alcoholics coming from such an adaptation than without having parents. So another strong indication of genetic contribution. if none of the parents is an alcoholic and you do an adaptation by families with an alcoholic, and adaptations by families without an alcoholic, then does not account for it. So even if you grew up in a environment where alcohol is a problem, if this is not your family, you are, I mean, it's not a protective factor, but if you take a lot of examples, there would be no problem. So this is a wonderful, actually the best review ever written, I would say, in the addiction field from David Goldman, in terms of the contribution of genetics, because he did this very nice summary of where he put all twin pairs, monozygotic plus dizygotic twins, for all drugs of abuse. So he had here 10,000 twin pairs, and he could make this estimation, and you could, can see that roughly 50% of the visceral is in the genes. So there is certainly a genetic contribution. He plotted also the relative risk of addiction. So there is a higher risk to get addicted by cocaine, opiates, alcohol, cannabis. And he found this nice relationship. I don't know how stable this is. Torger will give you better data, because in Iceland, do have a lot of amphetamine users and opiate users, alcohol. So he will give you the best numbers on this. But importantly, all these studies, twin pairs, helped so much to pin down the heritability of drugs. Now, as you all know, these days we're living in the time of genome-wide association studies, and if you reach often multiple corrections, hits that are above this magic threshold, you do have a genome-wide significant finding. A little bit stupid to take still this number, because it's it depends so much on how many SNPs you're testing, actually. So that would be a genome-wide significant finding. And we were aiming for this for quite some time, so we teamed up with geneticists in our institute, Marcella Rietschel, and also with Günther Schumann, and we did convergent genomic analyses. So we did a lot of animal work and human work, put it together, and we were able to get hits in at least three interesting genes. The alcohol dehydrogenase, so a gene that is important, very important in metabolizing alcohol. This is the most solid finding in the alcohol field. I mean, that's 100% certain that you will find several SNPs, can be in ADH1C, whatever, but in the ADH gene, in an alcohol metabolizing gene, there are variations. If you have them, this is a strongly contributing factor. That's very interesting, because this goes a little bit against our concept of, you know, if we're talking about addiction, we're all brain researchers, so we think that all happens in the brain. And Alan Leshner, he was director of NIDA in 1990. He had this wonderful science paper, Addiction is a Brain Disease and It Matters. It was good somehow for the addiction field, but it gave also a little bit of a wrong implication and thinking framework. Because I don't think that addiction is a pure brain disease. You could even, we have a developed theory, clock gene theory of addiction, that basically is saying there's a lot strong contribution of the brain, but it's a whole system disease, and especially in alcohol. If you do not take the liver, the pancreas, the stomach, in the gut, you know, where all these inflammatory processes, the cytokines, get induced, etc. If you don't take this into consideration, you will not understand the disease. So I don't think that alcohol addiction, and let's speak only for alcohol addiction, is a pure brain disease. And already the genetics tells you, my goodness, the biggest hit is in alcohol metabolization. There's nothing to do, that's a liver problem, another brain problem. Another gene, it's RUSGF2, which I will talk a little bit about, in ALGS2. I want to talk about this one, but these were the genes we detected, and there are now a lot of follow-up papers that do replicate these findings. So that was with the RUSGF2, that's mainly Günther Schumann and the Imagen Consortium working on this. And Günther was able then to get a lot of researchers on board, Europe-wide, and a meta-analysis was done on alcohol consumption. Here we're talking about alcohol consumption among 12 population-based samples with almost 30,000 individuals, in a replication sample with more than 20,000, so we're talking about 50,000 people of European ancestry. And we were able, beside this ALGS2, to identify one SNP in the RUSGF2 gene that overall just came to genome-wide significance. And this finding was made actually only in males, not in females. So this connection of the RUSGF2 variation. The RUSGF2, it's has several functions, but it is also glutamate transmission related gene that couples NMDA receptors to the activation, the RUS signaling cascade. And Anoa Bilbao, working in my lab, she did then a functional validation. I think it's very important that you provide convergent evidence. If you're doing genetic studies, it is not enough to provide only evidence from a CHIVA study. You have to do more. And one possibility is to go back into an animal model to knock out the gene, or even better, to introduce the human variation into the mouse rat genome, and then to study it. I mean, a humanized rat mouse model, that's certainly not always possible. Markus Heilig, he will talk about a wonderful model tomorrow, that a humanized mouse model of opiate receptor gene variants. But you can start off knocking out the gene and look into the phenotype that you have also phenotype in your human population. And here, again, the RUSGF2 is important in excessive. If you have this variation, the likelihood of having higher alcohol consumption is in this sense higher. So, so we took a mouse where RUSGF2 was knocked out, and we looked only into male animals because that was also the human finding, and these animals had free choice drinking, so with various concentrations of alcohol, always against water tested, 2, 4, 8, and 12%, and you can see that these animals do drink much less alcohol if the gene is not found. We tested this also in a so-called drinkometer system device. It's a very nice system because you do not interfere at all with the behavior of the animal, and you can track their night drinking activities. So this is what you see usually in a wild type animal, that during night hours, activity, motor activity is going up, and drinking activity is going up. And this is a typical day-night cycle, what you see in terms of alcohol consumption. So, and the RUSGF2, they have a complete blunted response throughout day-night times. So that's a pretty strong contribution. Interestingly, and here you see how strong translation can be. If you take female mice, no difference. As in the human situation, so this is what I would say, that's conversion evidence, and it's also translational evidence on what could be the reason for it. So why is there such a low alcohol intake in these male mice and nothing is going on in the females? And we know that the dopamine neurons that comprise the mesolimbic system, they arise in the ventral tegmental area, project the accumbens, release their dopamine, they are pretty much under control of glutamatergic input. RUSGF2 is important in glutamatergic signaling, RUSERG signaling probably on this level. So we were asking the simple question, does it affect dopamine release properties? Because we know usually if you drink alcohol, like all drugs of abuse, they increase dopamine. Nothing special, I mean, each reward is doing this. Not only each reward, almost everything is doing this. But still, it's an important thing in the addiction field that you look at the dopamine release properties. So we did microanalysis in the mice, and this is a typical picture. If you inject 2 grams per kilogram IP in mice, you get this increase in dopamine, and in the RUSGF2, no effect. Now, we haven't, and now we think, yeah, that's probably the reason. They already, in the very initial process, they don't get anything out of alcohol. This is why they don't drink. They don't get this initial increase that is probably important in forming these reinforcing properties. We haven't, and we should really do this, measure what's going on in the females. The prediction actually would be that female mice look the same in wild type. But here, and it's something that is completely overlooked, and it's a big, big problem of the whole field. There's a study from John Crystal's group, Harvard, published in Biological Psychiatry in 2010, where he showed that alcohol-induced dopamine release occurs mainly in males and not in females. I think that's a very important finding, and we should really put this a little bit into our framework. How important is dopamine is such a complex story. There's you cannot make any conclusions sometimes. But this study where they challenged actually with placebo and alcohol, females, and they did this PET study, they could not really see or interpret this as increased dopamine release. So this could be also the reason, and actually there are almost no studies in female mice with dopamine release properties with drugs of abuse. Very few studies, and with alcohol, I'm not even sure about the access. One single study with rats, yes, but not with mice. So one should do this. One should look into mice, female mice, how they behave. A big thing, anyhow, in the next couple of years, and Laura Volkov, she put it also on on her again, gender differences in addiction, how do females react differently, qualitatively and quantitatively, to drugs of abuse. Very important, very neglected, it should be done. And here is already an example of a qualitative difference.
Excuse me, sir. Is there any data about the serotonin level?
Serotonin level of alcohol?
After alcohol using,
yeah,
the level of
it, it goes up. It goes up also. To a, not to a high degree, but it goes up. I mean, basically, monoamines react to drugs of abuse in general. I mean, with cocaine, it's anyhow, I think that serotonin plays a more important role. So conclusion, convergent genetic analysis reveals that RGF2, the molecule in glutamate transmission and MAP kinase and ERK signaling, contributes to high alcohol consumption, and it probably happens while planting of the alcohol-induced dopamine release properties. So you see, if you're work together with geneticists. I mean, usually geneticists these days, a human geneticist is not interested in neurobiology. I mean, if they did publish one big paper after the other, and then you ask them, oh, you have detected this one SNP in gene blah, blah, blah. What is this gene doing? They even don't know. They don't care, most of them. So human geneticists have to talk to neurobiologists to put this into a biological framework, because geneticists are very much disattached of the biological context. Torga is not here to challenge him, but you have to develop here also again a real culture of exchange. It is very difficult, and also to publish with these people, it's no fun, because usually they have at least 100 authors. So if you contribute your data, your among a couple hundred authors, this is not what you're used to, and so it becomes a little bit difficult. Why do I present this RAS-GF2? Because I found it really striking that if you do genome-wide screening for variants, that you come up all of a sudden with a gene that maps into the glutamatergic system, not only into this, there's a lot of other functions as well, but also into the glutamate system. I found this very striking. I mean, the geneticists at first, when we discussed the data, they didn't care at all, because there is, as in many, many other fields, also glutamatergic theory of alcoholism. You know, it shifted from the dopamine to the glutamate to other systems. And logically, I mean, most excitatory neurons act through glutamate, not a big surprise. But nevertheless, the idea is, which I put up here, if you activity of the glutamate system, the end activity, what is glutamate doing? You plot it as normal activity, and if you ingest alcohol, the first thing is a blockade of NMDA receptors, because alcohol is a NMDA receptor antagonist. It's a blocker. So activity of the glutamate system is going down. And then you have, if you train further and further, you have adaptive processes. The system runs in homeostasis, no problem, as long as you drink alcohol. If you stop drinking alcohol, the system shoots up. You get a hyperglutamatergic system, urge of glutamate during withdrawal, and that this phenomenon can be also conditioned. So there is a conditioned withdrawal phenomenon where enhanced glutamate release is happening. Something that can happen even after years of abstinence. these situations of conditioned withdrawal of glutamate, enhanced glutamate, puts your brain into a state of high vulnerability to relapse. That's the idea. This is the dangerous part. So this hyperglutamatergic state that can happen also during prolonged time of abstinence might be a very on a very simple high level a trigger for relapse behavior. So we asked, are there any changes in the glutamate system in alcohol addicted rats? And here comes an animal model that we are working on since,
I don't know,
20 years now. Since 20 years. And I call it a DSM model, DSM-4-5 model. Piavi Piazza will present a DSM-4-5 model for token addiction. Why is that important that we're saying DSM? You could say, oh, what a stupid idea to already DSM. A lot of people think it's a complete artificial construct, right? So how can you develop then an animal model? And especially a lot of people think the DSM wasn't helpful at all for understanding, giving good diagnosis for psychiatric disorders, and developing new drugs, new medications. I think here's a little bit of a misconcept. And although the idea of Tom Insel at NIH is good to deconstruct DSM-4 and to go more into biological driven entities and to study these in terms of drug development, I think the biggest problem was that animal researchers were super ignorant to ICD and DSM. There were very little efforts to develop animal models that are really in the framework of DSM. And this is very true for depression research, for example. Yeah? These animal models in depression research compared of what we are having in the addiction field, this is Stone Age. Sorry to say, there is no addiction research. No depression research. Hopefully. You want to go to a depression lab. I would say if we would more develop DSM-like models, we would make better predictions for the clinic. Schizophrenia, the models we are having there, these are tiny, tiny proportions of the disease. And to make their assumptions for disease mechanism, it's a misconcept. How can you develop here new drugs? I think if you take this line, and I do agree, it's much more simple to do it in the addiction field because we have this wonderful situation that animals do take drugs. So we can use this. That's Valentina Wengel-Jene. She's working with this model since many, many years. It's called the alcohol deprivation effect model, but it's a little bit more elaborated. So animals do drink alcohol voluntarily, then they go through withdrawal, forced withdrawal, and then after the reintroduction of alcohol to the home cage, they do drink to intoxication. This is called the alcohol deprivation effect. And it looks pretty much like, here is baseline drinking. We have here a selected Worcester lines. They do drink anyhow a lot of alcohol. Then abstinence, and after that, you do have this typical alcohol deprivation. a very, very stable phenomenon can be observed in a lot of species. It can be also observed in humans, by the way. It was discovered in animals and then it was discovered in humans. It was somehow observed but never formulated. Scandinavians, actually, they have a lot of alcohol deprivation effects. They have this strange drinking behavior, Scandinavians, the most dangerous drinking behavior, by the way. They do drink much less alcohol on a population base than other countries, like 4 or 5 liters per year per capita, but they have really high rates of alcohol dependence because of Scandinavian drinking patterns. You do not drink for a couple of days, and then you have the opportunity, usually during Saturday night, and there you drink to complete intoxication. Or you go to the ferry to Denmark or to Germany, and the Norwegians, they get all drunken within 1 hour. So that's the alcohol deprivation effect. The most important thing is that this model, when we started to model it, first of all, there was a big, big problem in the field, or it's still a problem, that usually people offer 0 and 10% alcohol. That's a constant paradigm. It's not very good to do this. This is why most labs have a problem to have high alcohol consumption. It is much better if you give different solutions of alcohol, like here, 5 beer, 10 like wine, and 10, 20 spirits, as a free choice to the animals. And if you want to do a 2-bottle choice, never start with 0 versus 10. That's not good. Although 90% of the studies have done so, it is not a good way to do it. So you should then use increasing concentrations over time. Important is also that animals do not have only access to alcohol. Most important, they do not drink from time to time. That's actually the most important thing for an addiction. I think that the trigger for addictive behavior is not to take the drug. It is important that you take the drug, but also that you don't take the drug from time to time. Because during these abstinence or withdrawal phases, probably some important neurobiological processes are taking place that trigger addictive behavior. So we introduce these repeated deprivation phases, and we usually let animals drink up to 1 year. That's a long time, but you have to see that the typical situation in the clinic is that patients are coming to the clinic at an age of 45. This is where, not saying that there are people are having already problems at an age of 25, 30, 25 not that much, but it starts later on. So it takes a long time. It's not like with cocaine, where you have a much faster onset. With alcohol, it's usually, there are exceptions too, especially now with the binge drinking in UK. We will have a wave of problems coming in the next 10, 15 years. Especially in England, no other country will be so much affected. And we don't know about the consequences, but there will be strong consequences. But it is important that you do this on a long-term run. It's a very time-intensive, so labor-intensive to do this. But it induces a very specific behavior, because how we screen, I mean, we do have also other possibilities, but we do a quinine test. So if you would test after 2 months of alcohol drinking, first abstinence phase, animals that would have the possibility to choose between ethanol and ethanol plus quinine So you add a little bit of wine, it's a very bitter taste. Usually red stone has a touch of beer, very sensitive because all what is bitter tasting can be poisoning. So they do not relapse. And a lot of animals also do not relapse later on. But these animals, which we detect here as being addict rats, they are having this compulsive drinking behavior. Despite this quinine, they do drink a lot of alcohol during this alcohol deprivation event, so they are insensitive to this. So that can be used to divide addict versus non-addict animals. Pavi Piazza, he will present the three criteria model. It is also very much based on the one criteria of foot shock. That can be used also in the alcohol field, but you have here, because it's orally ingested, this very simple procedure of quinine testing. So Fernando Leonardi, he did gene profiling study in these animals. So we looked into animals that had only short-term drinking, 2 months, and first deprivation. And then those animals that had these repeated deprivations. And he did a very elaborated gene expression profiling study in the nucleus accumbens core shell at different time points. Very important. Non-addict, addict, H-match controls. I don't go all into these details. What is, however, important, a very important message that has nothing to do with addiction. If you do a principal component analysis and you feed in all the information on the temporal fluctuation of global gene expression, you see the gene expression over day nighttime is fluctuating a lot. 17, you have a completely different global gene expression than on these other time points. Z11 also separates. So whenever you do gene expression profiling, the same is true for protein profiling, the same is true for metabolomics, for all molecules, for all RNAs, they are fluctuating over time. So if you do a Western blot at 2 p.m., 10 a.m., 8 p.m., it will tell you different results, and you will make wrong assumptions. You can look through JBC or any other journal. Usually, Western plots, gene expression profiles, whatever, at one time point, and there you make your assumptions. Now, since at least half of your genes are fluctuating, and gene products are fluctuating over time, you have to do time course studies in order to make solid conclusions. I know that it is at least fourfold more work and much more expensive, but that would be the right thing to do. A very much overlooked phenomenon, only people who are working on the chrono field, chronobiological perspective, they are doing this. All the other neuroscientists, all other scientists who are doing this are ignoring it. Now, but it was a sideway. So we just one small result of this study, which is important in this content. So we defined at that time about 200 genes that map into, according to what we know from the biological functions, that map into glutamine signaling. These are probably much more genes that are important for glutamine signaling. Here in 2010, it was 202 genes according to the literature. And it was really striking to us that we had, out of these 202, 168 that were altered in the alcohol-addicted animals. Now, this, I think, is quite striking in terms the glutamatergic theory that you have so many genes all.
Can you clarify when was the tissue collected?
Exactly. Although I made here this previous statement, this is only one single time in this study. So even we did not follow this. So I have to say, yes, we have to do this also, and we do have the data to map this through all four time points. It will look differently, but at least it shows you that a good proportion of glutamatergic genes are altered. And here we're talking persistently, but they are altered after last time they had for 3 weeks no alcohol. So we did also, we selected some of these genes at that time and did also systematic analysis of glutamatergic neurotransmission genes in alcohol dependence in humans. So here we selected just these genes from the NMDA and PDE5 receptor class, etc. And at this very early stage, we were already able to detect SNPs in NR2B, subunit mChloro5, to be associated with alcohol dependence, which gives us, again, a good overlap of what we're seeing in the animals. So, in other words, there are some hints from these studies that this is indeed the case. So, alcohol is an NMDA receptor antagonist. A lot of glutamatergic genes are altered. Hyperglutamatergic state is happening. Is there really proof that this is the case? And the first study that was by Rossetti and Carbone, they published this in 1995, where they measured glutamate into withdrawal and saw this increase, hyperglutamatergic, this increase in glutamate, and it came down over 36 hours. And if you plot this against the withdrawal scores, so animals do experience withdrawal here in this situation, you see that withdrawal scores do correlate to this hyperglutamatergic state. That's in nucleus accumbens, but we made a meta-analysis and there are studies in the accumbens, in the striatum, in the amygdala, and hippocampus. And wherever you're looking into, and when you take all the data together, you have one very consistent finding. Glutamate is going up during withdrawal. It's very consistent.
So there's a little bit of a mismatch between glutamate and withdrawal score. So would it be that glutamate is not causal? Causing the withdrawal is on the consequence of
that. This would be that the glutamate would be the consequence of the withdrawal.
Not causing.
Not causing.
But responding.
I mean, there are many, many studies actually showing that the sum of the withdrawals. Variety of withdrawal signs, but some, like pod tremor, for example, is really due to glutamate. So there are studies, but I'm not saying that all withdrawal signs are really connected directly to glutamate. But I don't think there is any indication that it is the other way around, that the withdrawal symptomatology occurs, and because of that, glutamate would go up.
Can we say in this way that when the animal using or consuming the alcohol, depressing the glutamate in their system, release. So after alcohol decreasing concentration of alcohol in the system, now they have time to release, and they have now they are free to come out from the cells. Can we say like this?
Yeah. As soon as as alcohol is going below a specific threshold,
it
happens.
Yeah.
So it has some kind of individual in the release of it.
Yeah, sure. This is exactly what the idea is about. This was the scheme I was showing you.
And is it because of, for example, effecting of alcohol in expression of some transporting gene, transporting protein, which is leading to exocytosis of the glutamate processes?
I will show you some stuff.
This is a specific profile of glutamate that you saw with the acute, chronic, and the withdrawal. It's only with alcohol or also with other drug abuse?
With the enhanced glutamate during withdrawal.
In the case of opioid addiction, you have it in opioid withdrawal, you have also increased glutamate, and has been reported to be also responsible of some somatic manifestation of opioid withdrawal. So it's not exclusive.
But with psychostimulants, for example, it's much more complex.
Psychostimulant, I'm not aware.
And by the way, this seems to be a quite global thing. Although only a Kamitz writing amygdala has been looked for, I think it happens in other areas as well. But no data were available. In general, there seems to be that glutamate in the brain is going up. I think it's more of a global phenomenon. I don't want to talk about opioids, just alcohol. What is, however, very striking, and this is very rare in basic research, that when you take all studies that have been published, all are showing exactly the same. This is a very rare situation. The problem in basic research and in preclinical research is that if you look into the literature, it doesn't matter what you're looking into, you will find always very mixed results. One lab is saying this, the other lab is saying that. And yet then you try to find ways out of it. What is important, and this is what we are doing now for all, before we study anything, we're doing meta-analyses on the literature. A tool that is used in clinical studies since decades, it was completely ignored in the basic preclinical field. A very, very powerful tool, because at the end of the day, here we have more than 800 rats, animals, 800. Usually our experiments are based on 10 animals. These are based on 800 animals, where you get really convincing results. So meta-analysis it's time-consuming, but especially medical students, they like to do it as a thesis. So we have always 10 students who are doing only screening of literature for, if we're interested into a specific question, at first we are now screening the literature. We are not reading this anymore in, he's saying this, she's saying that. No, you want to have a quantitative analysis, and at the end of the day with a meta-analysis you are getting this. That's really good tool, really good tool. So in terms of translation, although in animals this is clear cut, what is the situation in humans? There is no direct evidence for this enhanced glutamate during withdrawal in humans. So we designed this translational spectroscopy study. If you put someone into a scanner, you can run also a magnetic resonance spectroscopy that allows you to measure protonate amounts. And we did so in 45 healthy controls, 45 alcoholics. And during the first day of withdrawal, acute withdrawal, the patients and controls were put into the scanner. From a clinical perspective, quite demanding to convince an alcoholic to go into a scanner during the first day of withdrawal. Something that a basic researcher would not appreciate, but is really challenging, it is to do so. And then 14 days later, with the animals, that was much more easy. We could do more scans. So before we started with the alcohol vapor exposure, and here later on we looked into after these repeated cycles of alcohol vapor exposure that makes animals very dependent, physically especially dependent. We're talking here about addiction, pure withdrawal, and then repeated scans. And Wolfgang Sommerberg and Eva Farr, they were involved into this, and this is in the human brain, the situation. So if you have to design a voxel here in the anterior cingulate gyrus with this size, and in this voxel, you measure glutamate. This is post-processing, so that looks wonderful, that you get this peak here, and you can then nicely quantify the content. And so the basal glutamate levels, I'm not talking about extracellular, I'm talking about glutamate. There are different pools of glutamate, right? Astrocytes from the blood vessels, etc. 9.4 millimole, keep it in mind. This is in the animal, you need better fetal strengths. So a 9.4 Tesla scanner we have used here. And this is how a spectrum looks like after post-processing. The voxel is placed here in the prefrontal cortex, like the ACC in the human brain, and this is what you can measure in terms of glutamate. GABA is always more tricky. Now we have a better sequence to measure also GABA in the mouse brain and in the red brain. And what I think is really striking, the glutamate levels in the red brain are exactly the same thing in the human brain. I think it's striking. A lot of people are saying, yeah, why not? But this tells us already on the level of pure neurochemistry, it is not that different. So this is a study population. These are controls, these are the patients, male, females, 32, 13, age match. This is exactly what I said to you. They present the case in the clinic around 45. This is typical. So very well matched here, 46 years. Alcohol intake, tenfold more. The audit, which is mastery for the alcohol dependence degree. And you see that indeed the glutamate levels measured by spectroscopy during day one are enhanced compared to healthy controls, they are going down over 14 days. This is, and you remember already the microdialysis data, the microdialysis that's extracellular, but it's striking that if you take pooled glutamate, you see it also in the red brain, that during withdrawal it's going up, and then it is having this time course that is very similar to what we're seeing. So in both humans and animals, there are elevated brain glutamate levels during alcohol withdrawal. Now the working hypothesis is very clear. If we, I mean, this is all very simple, right? From a pathological perspective. I mean, more glutamate. So let's say if we have a possibility to tune down glutamate levels during withdrawal, during protracted withdrawal, they should not relapse anymore. That's the idea. So this is exactly what we followed. And interestingly, there is a drug on the market, on the European market. It's called Campral, Camprosat. It's on the worldwide market. The suggested mode of action is that this drug actually dampens a hyperglutamatergic state. Because of that, patients do not relapse that much. Acamprosate reduces, indeed, dose dependently also in our DSM-like animal model, which I've shown you, dose dependently, it reduces this alpha degradation effect. So we see this also in animals. So the idea is that under acamprosate, the withdrawal response, condition withdrawal response, gets blunted in terms of glutamatergic activity. This work of Stephanie Berolens and others, where we were in the situation of having a mouse model that exhibits enhanced glutamate levels without having alcohol they have, because and it's an animal model per two, it doesn't matter, because they have a pretty down-regulated function of the clast of the glutamate transporter, or EAT1. So if glutamate is released, it's not taking up anymore into the astrocyte, it's shuttled back into the neuron, so there's an accumulation of glutamate. If mice exhibit such a hyperglutamatergic state in the brain, they should be more sensitive to a acamprosate treatment under drinking conditions. And indeed, if we measure glutamate levels in these PER2 mutants, this is exactly what I showed you. They have about threefold more glutamate here measured in the accumbent than wild-type animals. If we treat these animals with acamprosate, it does not affect the wild types. It does affect only the ones that have a lot of glutamate. It goes down. Has this phenomenon the consequence of drinking behavior? And it has. Because these animals, if we let them drink alcohol, they do not have threefold more glutamate in their brain. They have also threefold higher, and I say this also in quantitative terms, they have really almost threefold higher alcohol drinking. Two versus six here. And then you treat them with acamprosate. Acamprosate is not doing anything on the wild types. Acamprosate is bringing this down to wild type levels. As soon as you stop, it goes up again. So in this animal model, and there are now three other animal models, ENT1 and others, that show exactly the same pattern. So there is a strong link between enhanced glutamate levels and alcohol drinking. Does this translate into the human situation? So I told you,
Are there any inverse animal models where there's lower glutamate?
Good question. I don't know, probably. I mean, we have looked into clast knockouts, but they're so different. But the clast, they were not very helpful because they have so much counter-adaptive processes. But that's a good question. I'm quite certain there should be a possibility. I've not actively looked at this.
Are you aware of that?
So this is the work of Marcus Heilig lab. We're collaborating with, and as I said, you can measure glutamate patients. And so the idea was, what is doing acamprosate to this hyperglutamatergic thing? And
So patients were treated for 21 days with the caprosate. Here was the first scan, and then you can see through a caprosate treatment glutamate is going on. So again, translational evidence that there is a causal link between this acamprosate drinking and high glutamate levels. State of the art, 620 publications, a lot of approved drugs since 1989. Our initial work was very important to get it approved in Germany and other countries as well. All the animal work we did. FDA approval came much later, about 60 million euros in terms of sales per year. Now all over the years, more than 1.5 million treated patients. The drug is actually not doing that good, I have to say. None of the medications, also naltrexone, as you will hear tomorrow, is not doing very good. Let's say maybe one out of six patients might have a bit of benefit. Yeah? So our idea was to get to improve this because this acamprosate is N-acetyl homotyrosine, it's a drug, and it is responsible for the anti-relapse effect, which is responsible for lowering the glutamate levels, and it is a suboptimal product because it almost does not reach the brain. Although patients take 2 grams, they have to take 6 pills, 2, 2, 2 over the day, very challenging for alcoholics to do this over a couple of months. So we thought, why not generating a drug, an acamprosate, that more easily gets into the brain? We teamed up with Sinoport. Sinoport, they are, this is a company in California, they are really excellent in producing prodrugs. So they produce a product, some esters, neopentyl sulfonate esters. This was the work of Wolfgang, Nicholas Fischer, and Bernd Jandelheid. And we were really lucky and happy to see that compared to acamprosate, these ester prodrugs, carbonate prodrugs, they produce really high blood and also brain concentrations of N-acetyl homotaurine. So we thought, okay, now we do have probably better drug, and we wanted to go quite fast into the human condition. But just by chance, we all discussed this over years and years. It was a big program. But just by coincidence, I discovered that all these prodrugs are sodium salts. Nothing special, you would say. But acamprosate is a calcium salt. Calcium acamprosate. Now, these prodrugs are sodium acamprosate. And then I say, hey, guys, I don't know. We should be a little bit careful because I had this it is the most strange patent I have ever read in my life. 1982 filled in by Durach from the Meram laboratories and then went to Leva. The calcium salt of N-acetyl homotaurine may be used as neurotropic agent. The lithium salt may be used for bipolar patients. Wow. So we all noticed that lithium salts are good for bipolar patients. Zinc salt may be used in dermatology. This we all know, that zinc, all is based on zinc, right? So it seems to be that the N-acetyl homotaurine, the medication we're talking about, has no role. It is just the nature of the cation of either calcium, lithium, or zinc that is producing the effect. So I said, well, if you have no sodium salt, it might be good for local treatment, but not as a neurotropic agent. So maybe, although we get now much more into the brain, I don't know. So we said, let's test this at first. And
then we started, instead of calcium acamprosate, we treated animals with sodium acamprosate. And we had no effect at all in our animal model on the alcohol deprivation. Then we started to give different calcium salts. We gave calcium chloride, calcium gluconate, and the calcium salts produced exactly the same effect than the medication. Then we gave sodium acamprosate plus calcium, and we could restore this effect.
The concentration of calcium are the same.
These are all epimolar concentrations. Then, I mean, to base such a crazy idea on one animal model, we used then the Q&U reinstatement of drug-seeking behavior. I don't know whether have you talked about this model yesterday? So very briefly, I got you through the comics. A standard or the standard model in the addiction field where you can measure drug seeking behavior. Animals learn to have a specific context and a tone, for example, here, and the smell with the ingestion of alcohol by pressing the lever of an operant paradigm. Then on the next stage, a different condition, another smell, the animal presses the alcohol lever, no response. So there is another condition with the smell in a specific light or a water lever, so it's a discriminatory paradigm. Then, if the animals have learned it, you run the animals under extinction. So no cues are anymore presented, but the animals have learned it. So you get this typical extinction burst. They get into the chamber, they want to get the drug. Yeah, and after a while they are coming down. And then you do the reinstatement. You do present again here the discriminatory stimulus, and the animal start. It's not that the animal would get the drug anymore, but it can press the lever, and it's the condition Q. And then you can measure, without having any drug on board, you can measure the lever response. So it is a very good measure for drug seeking. Not more. This has nothing to do with addiction, just drug seeking. Okay. In terms of quantitative measures, this is how animals get trained for the ethanol water condition. This is the extinction burst, and after 15 extinction sessions, they are coming down, and then you can reinstate. Usually, the reinstatement response is lower than the training. Responses, but you see that this nicely discriminates between those conditions. And we have found already many years ago that acamprosate, also dose dependently, can reduce this reinstatement response. It's shown here, 100, 200 completely in rats reduced the alcohol seeking response. So we use this model also to test different calcium salts. And again, as you can see here, just concentrate. That's a normal reinstatement. If you give pre-treated animals with sodium acamprosate, no effect. If you give them calcium acamprosate, as we have reported 10 years before, completely blunted response, and calcium chloride is still the same. So we still could not believe it. We teamed up with two.
Excuse me, Charlie, again. The question is that for how long they got treated with these particles? I mean, because if they are using it for a long time, it can cause hypercalcemia, so they are bringing other problems with this treatment, especially cardiovascular problems.
They were. they had this abstinence phase, and then just a day before we reintroduced the alcohol, the calcium salts were given, or their Camprosate, and this was given then 6 times in a row. So a subchronic treatment. But you had already on the first day, you had an effect. So almost an acute response. So we worked then together with Paul Kiefer to do some clinical work, and Andrew Lawrence. And Andrew, he showed in his animal model actually the same, that sodium acamprosate is not having an effect like calcium acamprosate, and calcium chloride is pretty much doing the same as calcium acamprosate. Then we took plasma samples of patients that were treated with acamprosate and treated with placebo, and we plotted the first drink they had during their withdrawal, so when they first relapsed, and correlated this with the calcium plasma concentrations. No correlation at all on the placebo, but a correlation is more calcium in the acamprosate treated as later they had the first drink. And that also was the same for the cumulative abstinence. So there was a relationship between calcium.
Do you sodium and calcium in non-operant models of alcohol intake?
In
non-operant, yes.
The alcohol deprivation effect, that's a normal. That's normal. So it's operant? So, enhanced glutamate levels drive relapse behavior. Sodium acamprosate has no effect in 3 animal models. If you make such a finding, one experiment is not enough. Calcium salts produce similar effects than acamprosate in 3 different animal models. Plasma calcium levels correlate with time to first drink and time to severe relapse. Calcium seems to be the active ingredient of acamprosate. So basically, these 1.5 million patients that were treated with this drug, they could have taken 2 bottles of either one of these mineral waters that all contain high calcium, would have had the same effect. That's our prediction. A lot of people don't like these findings, as you can imagine. And it was really difficult to get it published, as you can imagine.
You didn't do the trial, no, with just a calcium.
This is what we are doing now. Certainly there is no one will ever sponsor this. To detect an effect, you have to test a couple hundred patients. Because what we know from acamprosate, it's not doing a lot. I'm not saying that anything was wrong from these 620 publications. And I'm not saying there is any effect. It's just interpretation seems to be wrong, that the medication is not having an effect. It's a salt. So the salts should produce exactly calcium chloride, the same thing, or any calcium supplement. We're doing this, but you know, to do a real big, large clinical trial that costs you a couple millions of euros, and no one would invest this.
I have a question in terms of designing the clinical trials. So should be the placebo sold as well?
That it has equimolar concentration, that's a good point. It is, for this it was never I think usually in placebo preparations, people Yeah, with the placebo, that's anyhow a bit of a problem. There is no placebo effect in animals. So yeah, there can be. You can do a design to demonstrate this. I do agree, but usually it's not built in. So whatever we do in basic research, there's a complete overestimation. Okay, always, our effect sizes are overestimations because we don't have a placebo condition building. We have a control condition building, but it's not a placebo condition. I'm anyhow that very much convinced that what we are doing in the clinical trials are right. Placebo condition is destroying medications, by the way. So you could take also this perspective. Because you simply destroy this part of the medication, you know? Usually there is not that much left, but you would not come now and would treat a patient, an alcoholic, with a placebo, just with a placebo. You want to have always a medication. So the placebo testing, I think, is something very problematic. It is difficult to have a medication effect. The medication effect has to be much, much better than the placebo. If you have a good clinical team, you do have an enormous placebo effect already. If you have a bad clinical team, then you have a better medication effect.
So, mainly for all the psychiatric disorders.
Yeah,
nicotine cessation.
For all psychiatric conditions, one should really rethink this problem a bit, because with the placebo we are destroying actively medications. You know, on the one hand it's good, on the other hand it's a problem.
I've got a comment and a question. The semester, I believe, was about Prozac, but it was around the same effect of placebo for depressed patients, but the depression level was mild. But it turned out that the Prozac is quite effective in severe depressed patients. I wonder if you could demonstrate such an effective composite in relation to the severity of alcohol addiction. Let's say maybe binge drinkers would respond more to a composite than that.
Yeah. The idea was also of a large project called PREDICT that we are running since years to screen patients for hypoglutamatergic states and to give especially those patients that exhibit such a state very intensively to give them a acamprosate. At the end of the day, it did not work out well, I have to say. So that's not that easy to do, because here you need a lot of patience. Because certainly with a hypoglutamatergic system, you don't have such a uniform response. There are huge differences. I'm not saying that this is one mechanism that accounts for everything and for each patient. I'm saying it can occur, and if it occurs, it is a driving mechanism. How much time do I
have?
Do you want to have a general discussion? I mean, I'm even at halfway through.
I have the same question, but in the other way around. I mean, do you take with the calcium plus the drug, or also in the animal model that you have with non-regulation of the transport, if you take other behavioral
In the PER2, yes, that was done. In the PER2, they also show a depressive light, for example. They have also higher anxiety. But these are comorbidities. I mean, the alcohol dependence comes in a pack with a lot of other psychiatric conditions, especially with anxiety disorders and also depression. Sometimes it's difficult to say what is first.
Then we can say that this is not, we cannot see addiction without touching others.
I mean, I think that's even an advantage. If you have a medication that touches comorbidities as well, then it's doing even better, right? I mean, why would you like to have a medication or any treatment that selectively only targets the dependence problem? Because these patients, they are suffering from other problems as well. Very often these are the reasons why they drink. So it's good to treat them for the other conditions as well.
Yeah, right, but what I understood is for example, the animal model with the regulation of transport, they have a depressive.
Okay. Right.
So you have presented this model of increased glutamate, which is somehow interfering with calcium signaling or homeostasis, or do you have any hypothesis as to what is the increased glutamate doing,
yeah,
signaling-wise or circuitry-wise?
That would be exactly the last part of my talk. You want to listen to the last part or to any other part? maybe we can do this. That would take... So, what could be the mechanism now behind this enhanced glutamate? Why? What is the cause of this? And is there any real pathological mechanism that we can track down on the molecular level that is in conjunction with this hypoglutamatergic state? Although I said this is a more general phenomenon, now we are getting more site-specific. And as you have heard probably, or as you will hear over the week, what is very important is that these dopaminergic neurons, they get also modulated heavily by glutamate at the level of the VTA, but also here on the level of the accumbens, medium spine neurons, activity, etc. You do have, especially here, one input from the prefrontal cortex that might be important. And that brings us now to the prefrontal cortex. And groups like the one from Peter Kalaivas, but also the group Everett, Cambridge, and others, they have constructed this very simple dichotomy. They are saying there's a functional dichotomy of the prelimbic and infralimbic cortex in terms of drug-seeking behavior. Drug-seeking behavior I've introduced, that's a reinstatement paradigm I've shown you. So activation of the prelimbic area actually leads to enhanced drug-seeking, whereas the infralimbic activation leads to reduced. And it's all related to glutamatergic output running through the accumbens core shell. Is this really true for all drugs of abuse? I mean, it has been shown for cocaine. With opiates, it's already different. It's not that. So the question for us was, is this simple dichotomy also true for alcohol-seeking responses? That's the Metzenberg from Simonetva and Marcus Meinert, are you better done? Now you have to switch on your videotaping, because this is all.
Looking, sir.